It's your girl Deshonda Carter, but you can call me DC. Thanks so much for tuning in today to my show, When the Blue Comes Off. Sit back, relax, take notes, do what you like, and let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my very special guest, Miss Easa Green. Welcome, Easa.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
So before we get into what it is that you do since you took off your blue, let's have a conversation and introduce the people to you. So you were a New York City police officer?
That's correct. I was a New York City police officer in the South Bronx for 13 years.
Wow. So what made you want to go into law enforcement?
You know, it's so funny because initially I started off as a traffic agent. And so I was writing tickets in Queens, Flushing, Queens, like, I guess it's called like the mini Chinatown. And so I wrote this guy a ticket in front of a nail salon. And he came outside with a sword and chased me around the car, right? So somebody called the cops. And as I'm being chased around the car, the cop car pulls up. He gets out, the officer gets out, smokes a cigarette, watching me run around the car. And I guess the Asian dude was like, you know what? Well, I had enough. I'm tired. So he goes back into his nail salon. I walk off, and the cop gets back in the car and drives off. And I was like, you know what? I'm in the wrong uniform.
So you're telling me that when the cop got out of the car,
yes,
he didn't address the issue?
No, yeah, I think, yeah, you know, to be honest, from outside looking in, it probably looked comical to him. He probably thought it was funny. You know, I don't know, but
there's nothing funny about someone chasing you with a sword.
No, it's nothing. See, you know, so he had the sword inside, even though, like, inside the holder, but even though he was still chasing me around, like, other people were, like, laughing, and, you know, so, you know, basically, traffic agents don't get no respect. They're like the bottom of the barrel.
Right.
So, you know, it is, it's, you know, that's just how the animal is. And, you know, I took it for what it was. If I would have had to fight the guy, I would have fought him. But, you know, eventually he just went back into his salon and the cop walked off and I walked off. But I knew that this uniform that I was wearing at the time, the traffic uniform, it didn't have enough respect from the public or anybody else. So that's why I decided to take the police exam.
Okay, so it was nothing other than the fact that you said, no, you're not going to treat me like this. I'm going to fix you. I'm going to be part of the New York City Police Department, NYPD,
exactly.
Baby. Okay.
Yes.
So now you were there for 13 years. Now, throughout your career, did you do the South Bronx in its entirety? Like, is that the only place that you worked?
Yes. I did the South Bronx only. I mean, I worked in the 4-0, I worked in the 4-2, and those are the only places I really worked at.
Okay. So now you said you did 13 years, so you didn't retire. So what was it that caused you not to continue your career?
I got hurt on the job, and I had hurt my shoulder, so I eventually had to leave because I was considered to be a liability.
So... Yeah. What was, if you had to give me a walkthrough on one of your worst days or in the department, like one of your worst experiences while working at NYPD?
Wow. I think one of my worst days I had, so I was very mouthy on the job. I was stuck up for blacks and things like that, and I was always a little combative with my superior officers because I felt like we wasn't being treated fairly. But so what they did was that they put me on a punishment post, which was the Crotona pool, the only pool in the South Bronx. So they gave me this assignment,
Well, I just want you to know, I've spent many a days in that Crotona pool back in the days.
Do you also, you know what I'm about to say?
Yeah, like, I do. Crotona Park was the only pool, you know, in the Bronx. Like, what pool you go to? We go to Crotona and we going over there to go get in that pool. Yes, ma'am.
Exactly. So it was like, I mean, so that's the only pool, right? So why would they put one cop for all of those people? You know what I'm saying? But it's a punishment post. It's really a punishment post at the time. So I'm standing there and I'm like, oh damn, now I'm on punishment. I'm gonna be here all summer. So the worst day was this. There was a riot between these two gangs, right? And so I noticed that this white guy, or he could have been white Hispanic, right? He was holding a little child in front of him. And he was at the edge of the pool because all the fights were happening like kind of like near the other end of the pool, like near the deep end. Mm-hmm. And so I'm looking, and so the lifeguards are like, Green, don't go out there. They fight. And if they see you, they're going to jump you. It's going to be worse. So I pull for backup. But the little baby was looking at me, and he stretched his hands out to me, and he was like saying, like, come and get me.
Right.
Mm-hmm. The guy behind him was smiling. So I went out there. I got the kid. I did get beat up. I had a cracked rib. I had a broken eye socket. Whatever the case may be, I called for backup, right? I grabbed him. So now I'm all bloody and I'm all beat up. So when I grabbed the baby, I go back to the area where the lifeguards is at because they had like a little gate you could close off. So the cops come, they shut it down, they stop, you know? So they call me an ambulance, right? And one of the EMS ladies said, Green, your arm is bleeding. I said, my arm is bleeding? How is it bleeding? She started wiping the blood. There was no cut. That blood was from the child's rectum. That man was raping that baby in the pool.
What?
Yes. And you know what? I searched for that man for the rest of my career every time I was in the 4-2. I'm not going to say what I would have done,
right?
But I'm just saying this. I looked for him. And because I could never, I mean, I'm glad that I went out there and got him, but I could never, ever get that image out of my mind. I can't.
Well, here's my question. Was the child related to that man? Because when you went and got him, the mm-hmm. man didn't say, like, you know, I got my kid or I'm okay.
No, he swam off. He swam off into the middle of the pool. I'm in uniform, so obviously I can't go in there and get him, but he swam off. But here was the problem at Crotona. A lot of the young mothers who have children, they start flirting with the guys, hanging out with the boys, and they let their children just wander off. Mm-hmm. You know how many missing children I had at the end of the day? Maybe on average of 5 to 10 children. And I had to wait for the mothers to finish doing what they're doing to come back. Oh, officer, I'm looking for my son, my daughter. We had them all in the office. You know what I mean? So that was a problem. So his mother was probably off, probably a gang member or doing whatever, and she wasn't keeping track of her kid.
That would have devastated me because I love kids. Anybody knows me knows that I love kids. And the fact that the man was able to do that. So what was it, a baby? Like, it was how old would you say that this child was?
Maybe between about 4 or 5.
And he was reaching out like, please save me. He knew that the police was to save. And he looked at you like, he couldn't say it to you, but those eyes was reaching you like, please come and save me.
Yeah, and I went out there, and as soon as I stepped foot out into the right, one guy just punched me right on the side of my face, like, boom. And but I knew that I had to get to the child.
Right.
So the blows were, so they wasn't hitting me after I picked up the baby, but to get to him, they were hitting me, punching me, kicking me, you know, things like that.
So you had to fight your way through.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had to fight my way, and I was the only cop there. So, and I don't know why with all the ruckus, why I caught eye contact. But after that, any mother that did not have or kept track of their kid, I was gonna put the cuffs on them, because it was so damaging and devastating to me that I just could not handle that again. So I was strict on the mothers. I would shut down the whole pool if one child came. Oh, I'm missing. Normally, I just let them stay there and just wait. I would shut down the whole pool. I would kick the mother out. I would lock her out for the whole summer. I mean, I was like,
you was not playing.
I was not playing with the mothers because they didn't understand it. There's sexual predators walking around. They look for opportunities like that. You let your little daughter go to the bathroom by herself. You don't know who's following her in there.
Right, because they're not dressed. They're in bathing suits, and they usually let them wear the little bikini type bathing suit. So yeah, that's not. I understand that.
I just couldn't, you know. So I had to get strict with these mothers, definitely. And a lot of them did challenge me. A lot of them say, you know, oh, because they were staying online for 2-3 hours. As you know,
yes, honey. Yeah, I know.
Right. So I will wait at the door after they stood online all those hours and say, "You're not getting in." And there was, and we fought. We had physical fights, but I was like, "You're not getting in here." Especially when I would see little babies with a stroller, and you could tell a mother's not going to be, you know, like they laughing and joking with the boys. They walking off with the stroller online because you can see from the balcony and stuff like that. I'm like, nope, she's going to be a problem. So that's one of my worst days, yes.
So let's lighten it. So in your career, what would you say that you walked away feeling really good, aside from that, because you definitely saved this young baby's life and, you know, this young child's life in terms of, you know, protecting him for further sexual abuse. But what was a great day that you reflect upon in your career to be like, you know, that was a good day out there?
It's like I had so many good days, but it was just like when I made a difference in mothers or single mothers. I guess one of my best days was that it was a father. So he would come to the precinct, and this is when I was inside at the time, and he wanted to get his children. But what happened was that he was coming, he said, "Officer Green, this girl, she has a new boyfriend, and the boyfriend is showing guns on social media, this and that." And so she was having to sit in the precinct for hours and hours, and the kids would come, "Daddy," and they would hug him, and they wouldn't want to go back with her. So I started writing, it's called DIRs, like domestic incident reports. And I started violating her every time she would come late or she wouldn't show up or she was just cursing him out on the phone and he would have her on speakerphone. I ended up helping him get custody of his children. And I was happy for that because with the road she was going down, with all the stuff she was put on social media with guns and drugs and everything, I think eventually that mother and the boyfriend got arrested. But that was a good day because, you know, it trickled down to making a difference in the children's lives and the fathers.
Right.
So that was, yeah.
Well, I'm glad. I mean, that's what I'm talking about. Like, people have such a negative vibe about law enforcement officers. You know, they always think that we're here to, especially you being PD out in the field, right?
Right,
that
right.
You're out there to harass and beat up and not realize, listen, you don't see what I see. You don't have the perspective that I see. You don't know what's going on.
Right.
You know, they'll take all of the good and make it damaging for the one bad.
Mm-hmm.
They'll clump everybody up. Oh, police in general are horrible because they have one or two bad apples, right?
Right.
And this is exactly why it's important for me to convey these type of stories, because we're not here to hurt or harm. We took these jobs, and I know I did, for a living, to provide for my family and myself, to have an ego and to say, you know, I'm law or I wear a badge. And for you, I can see the respect factor, because when you were in a different level of enforcement, you were disrespected. So therefore, you can say to yourself, listen, I refuse to be disrespected again.
Yes.
You know, but you also have a passion for helping people, which is what we're, you know, we will get into that when we get to your, the other things that you do outside of mm-hmm. your blue. But I mean, we're grateful, and I'm grateful and appreciative of women and law enforcement officers like you that go the extra mile to help people.
Yes, yes, definitely. And you know what? What the public don't understand is that we're a person in that uniform, you know? And they automatically, so I have to take the blunt of whatever bad apples, whether it be on the news, whether it be in my precinct. It's like if one cop messes up, we all have to get that blow. And, right. and it's just not fair. But at the end of the day, like, for example, I tell people, like, listen, I came from the same place you came from. You know what I mean? I was taught to them. I was like, you know what? You take the test. You know, and I told many people in the neighborhood, if you want more officers that you can identify with, take the test. You know, I mean, so it's like at the end of the day, you treat people how you want to be treated. And that was my motto ever since I put on this uniform. And also at the same time, me being a single mom with two children, it's like, I understand when you're calling and you're getting kicked out of your apartment and the landlord's calling you all different types of names and you got two little ones and you're a single mom. I get it. You don't have to be defensive.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Give me a chance to try to work it out, or give me a chance to try to help you. But automatically, they just see the blue and it's attack mode, you know? And, you know, they have to understand that there are some really good cops that care out there. There are, you know? And it's sometimes it just takes a two-way street for communication. That's all.
I agree. And I think the problem, especially in our community, you know, it's always been that black cop. You're in a position where it's so difficult because, you know, the community doesn't respect or, you know, law enforcement. And here you come as a black person, as a law enforcement officer. So they look at you sideways. You know what I'm saying? They're like, listen, are you with us or are you with them? It's very, it's a very, very fine line in our community. Where, you know, and it's we have to do more. And I think one of the things in law enforcement, there has to be more outreach. I remember growing up in my neighborhood, like, I knew my police guy that was on the corner. The police officer that was on the corner, he would talk to me. I knew the police officer in the train station when I would go in the train, because I would take the same train every day back and forth to school. And he would be like, hey, I had such a rapport. I remember his name. We would talk. How's things going in school? The community outreach has to be more. And I think they cut those in budgets. You don't have that anymore. The only time you see the police is when they're showing up for an incident. And I don't know if it could be, you know, a shortage. I don't know if it could be people, they just don't have those particular programs anymore. But we
You know what it is? Mm-hmm. It's the social. So with every job, the social atmosphere changes. Younger people come in, right? And then when the older people retire, that culture is gone. Like, for example, I would go into the project, take my hat off, and I will buy double Dutch ropes, and I would give it to the girls, and I would jump rope with them.
Right.
I would show them how to jump straight rope. I mean, double Dutch, because they didn't know how to do double Dutch, but I guess straight rope. But I would jump double Dutch with them. Or I would say, you know what? Let's draw some hopscotch. Like, what is that? But, you know, so these programs that the precincts have is more or less like, okay, what's a priority? Let's talk to the churches. Let's talk to this. Let's talk to that. But to actually speak to the younger people, you know what I mean? You know how many times people have came to the precinct like, Officer Green, my daughter refused to do her homework. She's trying to fight me. She's trying to do this. And I would say, okay, well, I'm going to put you in a cell with all these people that have, HIV, hepatitis, and all that. And I would show them the cell, and I'll do a scare straight with the parents' permission. And they'd be crying. And then they'll call me on the phone like, thank you. I appreciate it, Officer Green. I appreciate it. You know, it's like, you know, it's a cop's initiative, but they don't promote that type of behavior. They don't. So it goes according to what's the need of the department in that particular area. Like one father came and told me that his son kept calling the cops on him, and he was threatening to beat up his son. And his son said, "You know what? Well, I'm gonna call ACS, and you can't hit me. You can't do that." You know what I told the father to do? I said, "Go into that room, take that belt off, and spank his behind." And he was shocked. And he said, "Well, can I have your name, Officer Greenby? So if he calls," I say, "and if he calls, kick him out." Now that's old school. Right. Now you have a new cop coming in. They just might write a report like, "Well, there's nothing we can do." So it's a person. They don't actually support that type of policing. They don't.
Well, I think we need to get back to that, and that would help with a lot of this chaos that's going on out here. You know, they always say it takes a village to raise a child. And
Right. It's
not just in our community. I think society as a whole, you know, I don't care whose kid is outside and what denomination they are. If I see them doing something that they're not supposed to be doing, listen, you better stop that. Or I see you, you know, because they have to know that somebody is watching them at all times.
Right.
And it's not always somebody watching them for the good. It's people are watching for the bad as well, to see when they could potentially snatch them, do harm to them. Yes. So there's always people watching. But to wrap up this segment, had you not gotten hurt during your 13 years with the New York City Police Department, mm-hmm. do you think you would have stayed and retired from there?
Definitely. Yeah, because once you put on that uniform, if you're not going to stay the full 20, it's a waste of time. You might as well just leave. Because you don't get all your benefits unless you stay and do your 20th year.
And one more question. If a young lady came up to you right now, or anyone at this point, and they said to you, based on what your knowledge of what's currently going on in the police department, and they said to you, "Miss Green, you know, I just took the test and I'm getting ready to go in the next class," what advice would you give them at this time?
I would tell them, everybody's not going to be your friend. Don't tell people your personal secrets. Keep your nose clean. Do everything right by the book, even if it's going to cause you to be an outcast. And make sure you take the test and test up. And always be fair. And always talk to people like as if they're your family members.
Wow. That's exactly what we need in policing. You know what I mean? It's fair.
Yeah.
And in corrections, care, custody control, and consistency. You have to be consistent in your role and how you live your life in that blue uniform.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to thank you so much for talking to us about your time with the NYPD. We're going to take a quick break, guys, and we're going to come back and tell you what Miss Issa is now doing that she has taken off her blue. So don't go anywhere. Nah. Baby, I'm sorry.
This has been brought to you by Simply Carter Corp, your one-stop shop for all of your entertainment and party needs. Contact Simply Carter Corp for any special occasion. You can find them on Facebook at Simply Carter Corp, on Instagram at Simply Carter Corp. You can check out their website at www.simplycartercorp.com. Give them a call at 845-682-0022. Or you can shoot them an email at hello@simplycartercorp.com. Simply Carter Corp, a brand for everyone.
Welcome back, guys, with my special guest, Miss Easa Green.
Hey.
So now, yes, yay. So, Easa, listen, you guys are going to be blown away with the things that she is doing now that she has taken off her blue. So, Easa, I want to break this kind of up into semi-parts. So you have two businesses and two things that you do extremely well. So can we tell the people first about the tees? Let's talk about the tees first.
Okay. So my tees are organic tees. They are packaged in biodegradable packaging, which is good for the earth. Everything is organic. Everything is artificial flavor free, natural flavoring free. It is a cup of goodness with benefits. And and it's all organic herbs. Yes.
So why do we need it to be biodegradable? Like, why do you not? What did you, you did a, for those of you, I'm sorry, I didn't introduce, but I met Easa at a tea party, and it was a networking tea party, and she did bring some of her teas. And I'm telling you guys, the teas were phenomenal. I had the, what was the one I liked? The hibiscus.
Oh, yeah, the hibiscus blend. Yeah.
That was so good. It was really, really good. And why should people know that the biodegradable brown tea bags are better than the white tea bags that we would buy in a box?
Okay, so you can have white tea bags. I have white tea bags. You can have brown tea bags. But my tea bags are so it's corn husk tea bags, right? So white tea bags are bleached. Right? People don't know that. Your tea bags are bleached. Now they're just starting off with putting, have you guys noticed that they're putting your teas in like these little plastic tea bags now? So that's plastic going into hot water and you're drinking it, which is is highly cancerous. Another thing too, tear open your tea bag. Put it on a piece of paper towel. Smell it. Look at it. Especially peppermint tea.
You know, oh my God, that's one of my favorite teas.
Oh, please, please tear it open and pour it out on a piece of paper towel after you're done with this. And you know what? It doesn't even look like peppermint, but it smells like peppermint. You know why? Because they sprayed it with artificial flavoring, and that's cancerous. They made the artificial flavoring in a lab. You know, it's not like it came from the earth to inside an organic tea bag into your cup, which is what my product does.
Now, we just talked briefly while we were off the air, and we both said, listen, we're going to go heat up coffee. And she said to me, I hope your coffee is organic. And, you know, I'm not really a coffee drinker. I drink it now more than I ever have before, but I'm generally a tea drinker. So she says to me, I hope your coffee is organic. And I was like, no. And then I went into the whole thing, and we were talking about the tea bags. I said, well, I have a Keurig, and you know, I put the stuff in the Keurig and that's it. But she made a valid point about the Keurig. Can you tell them what you said about what we're doing when we use the Keurig?
So the Keurig is basically this. You put your pod into your Keurig, you close it, right? So it punches a hole through the aluminum top, right? Then now it fills up that pod with water, hot water, and it goes into your cup. But it's heating up the highly sprayed pesticide coffee into a plastic casing. So now you're having toxic stuff from the coffee, and now you're eating stuff, you're drinking from hot plastic, and it's going into your cup. There's nothing good about that situation. If you have to drink coffee, get the organic brown filters, put it in the old school coffee pot, and get organic coffee, because coffee is one of the most highly sprayed foods in the U.S. sprayed with pesticides. So you're getting a nice cup of goodness in the morning, and it's full of toxics.
Coffee drinkers, you Starbucks, you Dunkin' Donuts.
Yes.
We are killing ourselves. This is what you're telling me, Easa? Like,
yes, you have to have organic coffee. You have to have organic coffee. And the white filters, that's a cup of goodness of just bleach. You're getting a little bit of bleach into your coffee. So you know what? Go right into your cleaning closet, take out a cap of bleach, pour it into your coffee, because that's what you're doing every morning.
And that's what the white filters. So basically, you're saying anything that we have that's with the white, that's 9 times out of 10, it's bleached. So we have to be very careful in our consumption with it.
Yes, you have to be very careful with it. With the Keurig, it's also the highly sprayed coffee with the aluminum. being punctured. I don't know, the little particles may go into the coffee. I really don't know when the hole is being punctured. But also that plastic, that's like you heating up plastic in hot water and drinking it. Would you do that? Like, I mean, think about it. Would you take a piece of plastic, put it in a tea kettle, boil it, and drink it? No, but that's what you're doing when you have the carriage.
So what made you get into this herbal study and organic teeth? What was this something that was always in the back of your mind while you were working, or how did it come about?
Well, so being that I was really always into just like natural remedies and natural health, see, teeth are sublingual. Like, you could just put it into your, so teeth, think about this. Think about coffee, alcohol, anything you drink. It goes right and straight into your bloodstream. So what better way to help people is to make organic tea properties, or well, not properties, but organic tea that will help people with different ailments. So I wanted to help people. I was consulting people on their health and doing things like that because I went to herbal school. And they would ask me, do you have the products here? Do you have the products here? I would go to the grocery store with them. I would help them pick things out. Whole Foods, natural stores. And I was like, you know what? I can just make my own products here and sell it. It's a lot easier. And that's how I started. So I was like, you know what? What's the best medicine? You have tinctures. You have topicals. You have things. You have all different ways of medicine. But tea is one of the best ways because you can just simply put a tea bag into a hot cup and drink it. And it can taste good and be medicine at the same time.
So your recommendation is that at least get some type of, this would be a way of getting some type of herbs into your body.
Yeah.
And caring for your internal organs. Mm-hmm. As long as you ingest it directly.
Yes. Yes. Because people don't understand. So a lot of people take for granted what they put in their mouths and what they drink. That stuff hits your body, and it hits your body fast. And because it's a liquid, your body absorbs it fast, right? So when I put herbs into a tea bag, a non-bleached tea bag, it has the same effect. So it's actually benefiting you. Why not give your body what it needs to thrive? I have this motto I tell everybody. If you feed your body or give your body dead foods, then your body's going to die. If you feed your body live foods, then you're giving your body a fighting chance to keep living. Dead equals dead. Live equals live. So when you wake up in the morning, the first thing you give your body, are you giving it something that it can thrive off of, or are you hurting it? Which one is it?
Right. Well, you know, Easa, you're very informative, and I hope you guys are taking this in, because we're creatures of habit. You know, it's almost like the Matrix, that we wake up to do the same thing, same rituals every day, not realizing why we do it. It's just become habit. Everybody does it. Everybody drinks coffee in the morning. Everybody drinks tea in the morning, but not realizing the effects, you know, that it's having on our bodies. Or, you know, over the years, things have changed. You know, we're not actually doing the coffee grounds anymore. Everything has become so instantaneous that the faster you can make something, you know, we like that. But of course, the faster you make something, it's not good for you. The microwave is not good for you.
Right.
Now you're saying that you have to be careful, which makes perfect sense about the Keurig, because it is the plastic and it is being heated up, and I use it. So, you know, what you're saying does make sense, and I hope you guys are taking heed and taking this in. And, you know, even if it's difficult to try to do away with it immediately, I think it's something that we definitely need to start to look into as far as health-wise, because too many people are dying of cancer. Too many people are just dying of so many, just the things that we're ingesting into the body and damaging the liver, the lungs, you know?
Yes.
So, I thank you so much for sharing that part. Now, where can they find this information, and where can they find you so they can learn more about their herbs and the different teas that you provide? Where can they find you?
So I have a website, easagreens.com. So it's spelled E-A-S-A greens.com. That's my website. I'm also on Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok. And they're all spelled the same way, Easa Greens.
All right, guys. So make sure you follow Miss Easa Green on all platforms. And especially if you want to at least try something different, something that's not that may not be readily available to you in your local stores, you know, something of a different caliber that you can at least compare it to. So shop on her website, go on a website and check and see what she has. Now, Easa, let's talk about the other creativity that you got going on as far as the hair products. Tell the people what's going on with you, Miss Herbalist. Tell them.
So I actually created three products. I created a hair shampoo, a hair softener, and a hair oil. My hair shampoo, I actually get Ghana soap from Ghana. And I have it shipped over here, and I break it down into shampoo. And with that being said, with this shampoo, you're able to wash your hair, and you'll make your hair nice and soft. You can also wash your face with it and your body with it. I also have a hair softener that if you have tight curls and you want your hair to be better manageable, you can spray it in your hair. And then once you go underneath the shower or you wash it, it softens by every time you use it. So I create that for naturalists. I also created hair oil. So the hair oil has 100 herbs in it. And the reason why I create these products is because I'm sick and tired of products and you turn the back of the product to read what's in it and you can't understand nothing that's in it or it's filled with chemicals. Because what a lot of people don't realize, our biggest organ is our skin.
Right.
So whatever you put on your skin, you're ingesting. So whatever you put on your hair or on your scalp, you're ingesting. So I want to make an organic line. And that's where it came from, basically.
So they can shop this also on that same website that you provided?
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm.
Okay, guys. So listen. You've been put on to some... Don't say I didn't give you... goodness today, okay? Because we got a bowl or a cup of goodness today and of knowledge and things that we should, you know, do, especially in our latter years, right?
Yes.
And if we teach these good traits and habits to our younger counterparts, maybe they'll have longevity and healthiness longer than we do, because now they're transitioning back into natural herbs and natural herbs
and just, you know, and even if you're sick or you feel like your body's just not right in your latter years, you can actually make a turn or a change for the better, you know, because it could be that cup of coffee you drink in the morning can actually make you feel bad. You never know.
And not even realizing it, because society, the whole world drinks coffee, right? There's never been anything that says, hey, don't drink coffee, right? So you're right. You know, it is something. And you don't even hear doctors tell you, don't drink coffee. You know, there's doctors who get up every morning and get a cup of coffee every day.
Right. And, you know, the only thing is, I'm not saying coffee is bad. I'm just saying make better choices. Organic brown filters, organic beans, you know, things like that. And, you know, make your coffee better. I mean, because if you are doing the quick route, like how you said, Dunkin' Donuts, Starbucks, or the Keurig, well, you get what you pay for. Quick doesn't mean that they care, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's a quick turnover. They just, you know, they do what's good for them. But you have to do what's good for you. Right. So make your coffee in the morning. Go to the store and get the filters that are unbleached. And you'll see it. You'll see it right next to the bleach ones. And you know what? Take out 5 minutes extra in your day to make yourself organic cup of coffee, organic cup of Easa Greens tea. You know, things like that. Those little small changes make big ripples in life.
I love it. I love it. Oh my God. Thank you so much, Easa, for being on the show.
Thank you.
Oh, of course. You know it. And guys, again, the website is isagreens.com.
Yes.
And Easa Greens on all platforms, TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook.
Yep.
Any last words you have, Easa?
I want everybody to have a nice, blessed day. That's it.
All right, guys, you heard it. Everybody have a nice, blessed day. I hope you guys enjoyed the show, and I look forward to bringing you many more, all with positive vibes. Remember, whatever you do, do it from the heart, with love and passion. Stay safe. Talk to you.